We shall begin with our session, and in that we will.
So good morning again to all of you. Thank you for to discuss the COP plan. The theme for just this morning, we were recapping on the key issues from high-level messages and the technical messages.
You've got the Secretary of Agriculture, David, for the morning. Important factors, the team leader of the Economic Cooperation Agriculture, European Union, Emmanuel, UNEP. Good job. Other members from other development partners, Professor, the Dean of the College of Agriculture, FNU, and other staff from FNU, our own staff, and the Robinac Bureau. I want to thank PS for organizing this forum. As captured from the deliberations that are reading papers today and have on air. The key purpose of this meeting is about developing the cost of question plan. Now, the expense of repetition, let me give you a little brief on why it's important to have that, why it's important to have the processes and systems in place. Every institution, every country, every organization wants the maximum out of a given dollar, given kitty, given budget. And one of the key factors that will contribute towards achieving that objective is to have a defined plan, a defined system, a defined process, so that everyone sinks in line with that particular system or process. So you minimize duplication. So in that process, you are able to save a lot of resources. So efficiency of resource reuse is at the heart of delivery in any organization, whether it's government, whether it's a household, any DMU, any decision-making unit, they would want to get maximum output for a given resource, given bundle of resources. Therefore, it's very important that you have a defined process, a defined system that everyone takes ownership. This meeting today, you all here, is one to jointly develop system and processes. Two is to agree on that particular system and processes and have a better understanding of it. But more so, to take ownership of the systems and processes. You're here with the Deputy Secretary, yes, directors, all of you, to give your input at this particular process. The other thing is that you then go back and you are heads of sections, heads of divisions, that you will sit down and talk to your staff, that they will need to follow, sink in with that. Also, the owners of the resources must also ensure good governance in resource use. So when you have a system and a process, you will be able to ensure that proper governance practices are taken into account when utilizing those resources. It is in taxpayers' interest. We are, at the end of the day, acting on their behalf and their interest. in public interest. There's a huge literature out there about public interest. What is public interest? Some time back, when we had one TV station, and there was an application to have another TV station. And at that time, the Commerce Commission Act was at its infancy stage. And I was asked to write a paper. First of all, in support of why there should be another TV station. And then I had to look into this whole literature about public interest. And in government, you must always understand that public interest is paramount. And you are here to serve the public in their interest. And their interests are defined and captured in the budget document. This entire process of elections, government, governance, and that document, the budget, that document is in public interest. Given that the budget is an annual document, you then have development plans to ensure that the budget is in line, ensure that the development plan, strategic development plan is in line with the budget, strategic development plan is also taken together. That is something that we'll talk about in another day. But today, ladies and gentlemen, PS yesterday talked about operational matters. I am a person who believes in knowing the entire institution's operations. But I don't want to be accused of being a micromanager. But there are different terms utilized, whether it's micromanagement, etc. But any person who's head of a particular institution must know what's happening at every level of the particular institution or section. I strongly believe in that. But PS is totally focused on operational matter, and we, the policy level, the government, the cabinet, ministers, we map out the overall policy direction. And I want to take a little bit of time on this policy direction that we all must see and be able to deliver. Ladies and gentlemen, recently I said somewhere that agriculture sector is the most important sector for Fijian economy. And if you look at the growth trajectory of any country, both developed and developing countries, except for some outliers, agriculture has been the main sector which supported the growth and expansion of the non-ag sector. Normal trajectory, the number of agriculture models which define that trajectory. Agriculture, commercial, industrial, service. But still, agriculture sector continues to play a very important and critical role for several reasons. If you look at what's happening in some of the countries, you will find that with the level of development they're having, there is a shift towards more commercial, industrial, and service orientation. And that is also moving people out of agriculture sector. Fiji has a strategic advantage. Fiji has a strategic advantage in agriculture. And I said a few weeks back that yes, tourism is a very important critical sector, but we cannot totally depend on tourism sector and remittances, because these two sectors are not within our control. They're not in our control, but agriculture sector is in our control, just like shocks, external shocks, internal shocks. There are shocks to the economy which are beyond our control, and there are shocks to the economy which are within our control. And what is within our control, we must have a total control, total capture of the agriculture sector. Amongst these sectors in the economy is a sector where we have a strategic advantage and we can have a total control of the particular sector. It is in national interest. I want to repeat that. It is in national interest that we promote agriculture. It will provide you a stable, sustainable and growing source of income, national income for the country. And of course, that national income will cascade down to micro level units. We have health and nutritional dimension. We have livelihoods linked to agriculture sector. It is a sector which does not discriminate with respect to the number of skills of workers. It is probably the only sector which does not discriminate. Anyone can engage or get engaged in the agriculture sector. You don't need to have a particular skill sets. And then you develop your skills over time in that sector. It is the only sector which contributes positively within our control to climate change. And therefore, any additional significant non-zero growth in the agriculture sector contributes towards our quest to build resilience to climate change. So again, ladies and gentlemen, it is in our national interest that we must grow and build resilience within the agriculture sector. Gone are those days where we promote unplanned agriculture development. We have to now plan agriculture growth and development. We have, as I said, strategic advantage. We have good climatic conditions, we've got good arable land, and we are larger to good market where we have our own a significant, small but significant, sizable total population, which has our own taste and preferences. Psychologically, they would want to consume products from Fiji. We need to exploit those markets. But I've said that we haven't exploited the market in our doorstep, in our doorsteps. Our tourism sector in itself is a massive and huge market for our products. For long, tourism sector has not done justice to our agriculture sector. They have been saying, they've been making all kinds of accusations that we are not supplying products consistently, we're not producing quality products. But I think those are very lame excuses. I mean, all of you have stayed in hotels. How many times have you gone to a hotel and said that I want to have for vegetables, asparagus. I want to have those vegetables which are not found here in Fiji. That's what I want to consume. Never. How many times you have gone and picked up a banana and said that there's some scratches here, I don't want to eat this banana. Why aren't they saving imported fruits there? Which tourist comes there and says that I only want to consume grapefruits, oranges, pear, etc.? They're not doing justice. They're just too lazy to do proper procurement, do them some extra work to procure from our own producers here. There's no question about not having adequate supply. Why are we exporting if we don't have adequate supply? So ladies and gentlemen, the tourism sector has to come clean, have to come work with us, partner with us, so that save the foreign reserve that is flowing out of Fiji, our own currency. Ladies and gentlemen, what we are asking for peers by putting the strategic documents is that we all need to share a common vision. All of us, the ministry, have to share a common vision that we need to grow agriculture in national interest. Unless and until, right down to the rank and file within the ministry, shares this common vision, it will be difficult to really drive down agriculture and grow agriculture. I must say And over the last, two months, we have got farmers to understand this notion about commercial agriculture. We have made it very clear to them that if you are doing hobby farming, if you are doing part-time farming, leisure farming, you know, you can continue to do that. But don't expect us to pour our national resources, which is not in national interest. The national interest is to get agriculture to drive growth and development of this country. But they are thinking, they all are not talking about commercial agriculture. They are not talking about surplus creation. And we're explaining to them, what does surplus creation mean? What does it mean to be an agriculture entrepreneur? There is a transformation, movement from family farms, owned by family farmer, towards commercial farm led by agriculture entrepreneur. They're understanding this. It's a national movement. But then, all of us have to think in that, with that as well. All of us, in terms of service delivery. We can have a lot of resources. We can have a lot of plans. But the real challenge in a lot of developing countries is service delivery. That is where the challenge is. That development partners are moving towards putting more resources, developing capacity, trainings to ensure that service delivery is dealt with. That's where our problem lies. Ladies and gentlemen, while we are changing the mindset outside, I must say that we have not been able to change our mindset within. We still receive a lot of complaints with regard to service delivery. MPS yesterday spoke about those, and I don't want to keep this session in a positive tone. So ladies and gentlemen, we have a major task ahead. We have a major task ahead, and we are now partnering. We have got, first time ever, from recent years, the national institution, our own university, rising up and wanting to work with us, to support us in research and providing expertise. I think they now have an animal breeder that came in, which will be a huge support to our team. We can share resources. They can do research with us. They can teach there. They can bring their students to do attachments and research. We have now IMA, Agro Marketing Authority, and food processors. They're now talking amongst themselves. They're now working with us because they now share the common vision. And we have now are mapping out strategies how we could get them to ensure that we take market to the farmers. You go and read the picture. In any country, at the end of the day, what will stimulate production and supply is market provision. And all along, we've been pouring in money to stimulate production and supply. But that's not sustainable. That's not sustainable. We should never pick up operational cost of any entity. Yeah. That's not sustainable. You will create a dependency mentality. What we should do is set the framework, provide technical support, and pick up the capital cost. Ensure that they have the enabling environment to launch their entrepreneurial activity. We're not going to get into the operational side and pick up. We're not sharing the proceeds. The realtor will not share the cost. We will give them a helping hand and leverage once. We want to come in and provide market signals to stimulate production and supply. Go and read the articles and papers this week, what farmers in Nandaribadu have said, what farmers in Bar has said, what farmers in Rakiriki have said. And they were struggling to dispose of their product. They were traveling right from interior, getting the potatoes, getting the produce, come down to Tabua, and then these people will dictate the price because they've come all the way. They have no way to go back again, take the produce back. We now, we pick up the produce. Of course, we now going gradually in terms of what produced, because we need to ensure that we have the market. We don't want AMA to belly up. We don't want food processors to belly up. So we are saying that you find the market, sign, secure the market, and then we will promote the particular crop. So at the moment, with the seven crops that we have outlined to the farmers, that you produce these crops, any amount, we will pick it up, we will give you, guarantee you a price. That price may not be the price that is in the market, slightly less than that, but at least it's a guaranteed price. Of course, we will have to pick up our own cost as well. The question then is, with this change, are we ready to provide them with the enabling environment? We are now promoting these crops. Do we have the seeds and seedling? We are promoting movement towards, as far as possible, gradually over a period of time to organic farming. Are we ready with the organic fertilizer? Will we have a major savings in terms of importation, the amount of money we're spending in importation of fertilizer? Are we ready to support them, to protect them from pests and diseases? Are we ready with leverage packages for every type of farmer? Are we ready with respect to land drain and farm road and drainage packages? So, ladies and gentlemen, this is the framework I'm talking about. I will be totally focused on the output side. That's where I will come in, and I'll leave the entire operational side to PS and his team. So I think that we are at a very exciting time. If there's any motto that we all should agree on and kind of chant as a mantra, it'll be growing agriculture in national interest. And that's what we all should. But again, as PS has said yesterday, all of us, there should be a sea change in attitude. All of us, while we are taking this agriculture forward in terms of framework and the goals, a sizable proportion of our staff are left behind. They're still limping and trying to catch up with this thinking. We need to get our own house in order. All of us. I thought of reading an email out, which was sent by a farmer in another delivery, Sigurdurga Research Station, to Minister of Civil Service about how he was treated when he requested for a particular service. The email was sent about a few days ago, sent to ES and myself. That tells volumes about what's happening in the front line. Again, that might not be in every station, but that's a big reflection on us. While we're trying our best to ensure that we live up to the national expectation, there's some staff who are really not doing justice to our national cause. So, ladies and gentlemen, I want to thank you all. As I said right at the beginning, it's important that we have transparent systems and processes, not only in terms of gaining efficiency, but it will help us ensure the resources are put to best use and it is in national interest. With these words, I want to thank you all for being here, and I look forward to working with you all. I think all of you have a stock of wisdom that we can utilize to leap forward the agriculture sector. Thank you.